of Culture's Reggae Celebration, where for the last 18 months we've been working with the community to uncover stories around reggae and Brent's reggae history as a powerhouse of production and distribution across the area, in particular Harlesden. We have done that with working with the community and providing a platform in order to document these stories and take them forward so that they are preserved as part of our history. Tonight we bring to you an amazing panel which has been chaired by Lindsay Wesker, and it's going to be covering the topic of pirate radio station and the Black British music economy. I'm going to be here as opening up. I'll also you'll be hearing me throughout the stream answering questions, and at the end of the stream I will come in and give you further information about the future panel talks, as well as our the pinnacle of the No Baseline Home program, which is our live stream at the weekend, but more about that later. So just a bit of housekeeping before I wrap up. So please feel free to use the chat. We want all your comments, all your reactions coming in. The Q&A button is there where you can put your questions in, and in the chat you can direct message the panelists. Let us also know where you're coming from. We want to know if you're where you're listening in from. Are you from Brent? Are you from across London? Are you international audience? And also, for those of you who might want to access the closed caption, please use the closed caption icon at the bottom of the screen here and click on there where you can follow along. The other thing just to say, one of our panelists, Mikey Coos, is running late. We hope that he will be able to join us, so you might see him pop up throughout the conversation. And on that note, I'm going to hand over to Lindsay.
Hello, everybody. It's lovely to have you joining us on this a cold and damp Thursday evening. Thank you for taking out the time to come and join us. It's going to be an amazing panel. I really hope you enjoy it. We really look forward to all of your interactions. So, you know, if you've got any questions to ask, please ask them. First of all, let me give you a little background about me and Brent. I've been in Harlesden for 35 years now. I married a Harlesden girl. I met my wife at the Apollo in Willesden in 1982. And so I've been in Harlesden for 35 years now. And my experience of pirate radio, my good friends, Max LX and Dave VJ, the Mastermind Roadshow, got me my first gig on a pirate radio station, on a station called Invicta. I lasted 40 minutes on there before the DTI were banging on the door and I had to escape out the back window with my records. I then joined another station called LWR, and I was on London Weekend Radio for a while, and I know Ernie was on there as well. I then joined JFM, where I met Gordon Mack, who later created Kiss FM. And then I joined a pirate station called Kiss FM in 1986. And I worked with them and helped them get a legal license. So that is my background in pirate radio. In between all of that pirate radio activity, I actually worked in record companies, and I used to do radio promotion while I was in those record companies. And I knew that if I wanted to get on three certain pirate radio stations in Harlesden, all I had to do was come to Harlesden High Street, and there were literally three pirate radio stations in a 100-meter stretch on Harlesden High Street. It was the easiest piece of promotion I did. I went in one door, walked a few yards, walked in another door, walked a few yards, and I was able to service three pirate radio stations in about, you know, 20, 25 minutes. Why was pirate radio so big in Brent? Why were there so many good pirate radio stations in Brent? And why is pirate radio so important? Let me just show you some photos. Here we have some archive photos. You can see some of the primitive aerials that transmitted these pirate radio stations. The two highest points in London were Crystal Palace in the south and the Trellick Towers in Swiss Cottage. So you had to have your aerial on one of those if you wanted to get the best possible coverage. So here are a couple of photographs of some of the crazy aerials that we used. This is actually not a pirate radio studio. This is actually Radio Caroline. I mean, Caroline obviously was a pirate radio station, but kind of not one of the black pirates of the kind of 80s. These are the original pirates. I mean, this is they made a film out of this called The Boat That Rocked. And then here you have some pirate radio equipment, probably confiscated by the DTI. So you can see all sorts of boxes and gizmos confiscated by the Department of Trade and Industry. So the next photograph shows the original Kiss FM lineup. This is from 1988, and you can see Gordon Mack, the guy who created the radio station, right down the very, very front. And sadly, there are quite a few people in that photograph who have passed away. Just to the right of Gordon, you can see Colin Faber, who passed away. Just above Colin, just below Dave VJ, you can see Paul Trouble Anderson, who passed away recently. And one of the Manasseh guys passed away as well. So it's quite an iconic photograph. And the photograph on the right is of a group of people who were assembled to do a BBC television documentary. Just second from left, you can see Rodney P from the London Posse. And just to the left of him, you can see Jay Davidson from Radio One. And, you know, we were all gathered together to do this documentary. You can see Jumpin' Jack Frost there and Norman Jay and, again, Paul Trouble Anderson, DJ Elaine, all sorts of really, really good people. And we all came together for this documentary. And thankfully, the BBC show this documentary every now and then. You can kind of see it on the BBC every now and then. And you can see us talking about the 80s. So, let me introduce you. Oh, hang about, I've got one more photograph. Sorry, one more photograph here. So this other photograph here is from an event that me and Dave VJ created at the Harlesden Library. And just to the left, you can see a book that me and Dave created a few years ago called Masters of the Airwaves, which is kind of the history of kind of British black music radio. And what we managed to do is, I mean, we didn't write it, but what we did was we gathered together everybody and we asked them to tell their story. So if you ever see a copy of the book, it's absolutely amazing. You've got a page of Robbie Vincent and a page of Greg Edwards and a page of Trevor Nelson and a page of Norman Jay. And it's a fantastic book. And Ernie very kindly joined us at the Harlesden Library. We did some promotion for the book. And you can see George Kay to my left, and George and I, And to the left of George, just in the far corner in the blue T-shirt, you can see Lewis Mastermind, and all three of us, we now work on a station called My Soul. So let me introduce the panel. The panel are just absolutely amazing. We've got some fantastic people for you this evening. First of all, Shayna Marie Birch-Campbell.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi.
Now you are the breakfast show presenter on Capital Xtra Monday to Friday, 6:30 to 10.
Yeah.
You need to go to bed soon, don't you?
Honestly, it's late already, but I'm happy to be here, so thank you.
Well, we really appreciate you joining us. You also have a DJ mix show every Friday night between 10 p.m. and 1 a.m.
Yeah.
You are busy.
Yeah, busy girl, but I get to do the best of both. I get to present and I get to DJ as well. So, yeah, super great.
How are things at Capital Xtra? Is everything going good there?
Yeah, really good. I've been there almost 2 years now. Had the breakfast show just over a year. And, of course, with this, the weirdest year that we've been through ever, things have been a bit crazy. But, yeah, really good.
Good. Thank you. And thank you for joining us. We really appreciate you taking time out of your crazy schedule. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
Erica McKoy as well we have tonight. She is a presenter on my friend Giles Peterson's Worldwide FM. Do you have a weekly show, daily show?
Well, actually, I had a daily show. I've recently come off air. As in like last week, I think this week is my first week not doing any radio shows. But I'm still working with Worldwide FM obviously, and just working behind the scenes. But yeah, Worldwide.
I mean, doing a daily show is tough. So I understand why you gave it up. That's a tough schedule.
It's intense, but do you know what? I did love it. And I miss it. Like this week has been really weird. Like going to bed So I usually plan my shows the night before, and I just kind of, I get to the evening and I'm like, oh, what am I meant to do? But the mornings were incredible, and yeah, like I had a really lovely group of people that would always tune in. So yeah, I've loved doing it.
Are the audience for Worldwide FM, I mean, they're really passionate people, aren't they? They really know their music.
They know their stuff, and you can't go into it not knowing your stuff. You have to, if you're a presenter on Worldwide FM, you have to know your music. So I'm really grateful for that slot that I had on Worldwide. I'm kind of lucky that Giles trusted me. I mean, Giles has so much knowledge himself, so
Giles is good people. He really is. So, you know, good organisation to be part of. We love Giles. So we really appreciate you taking the time out of your schedule to join us, Erica. So thank you very much. And we can't introduce Mikey because he's not with us yet, but we're gonna introduce you to an absolute living legend of radio, a Brent legend as well, the man they call Daddy Ernie.
How are you, brother? How are you doing? How's the panel, everybody? Boom, 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 boom. We're here. Looking forward to it, man. It should be very interesting. The time that we've got is not going to be enough, but we'll skate through now.
Definitely not. We definitely don't have enough time. So you, I mean, as I said, you were on LWR.
Yep. Well, my career in music goes back way, 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 way back from about the age 10. I mean, obviously, you know, it's well documented that my father had a sound system from the early days. And this was a thing that was amongst the youths of Brent. Everybody had a little thing, a little music center or something. Mm. And of course, some got big, some just kept it at their house. We was fortunate enough to kind of create a sound system called President Downbeat in our school years. We used to do parties and clubs and youth centres in them days. And then we progressed, obviously, onto Hawkeye Records, where we really sort of stepped up. You know, we had Hawkeye International. Before that, it was Rima Sound, and then we turned that into Hawkeye International. Then we got Hawkeye International Sound itself. It was safe to say that although Java from Crenshaw Rise was the big sort of bashment sound of the time, we was kind of the girls sound. We had a lot of girls following us and a lot of party style and champagne drinking and brandy drinking and all those things.
We love that. So, we love that.
Yeah. And at the time, I was very good friends with Tim Westwood, and he said to me one day, why don't I come over to LWR and do a reggae show? Hmm. What are we talking about on radio? So anyway, we got over there, and Zach, who owned LWR, he had heard about me, and he said, yeah, man, you can come on 7 till 9. So I'm, you know, here I am, boom, I'm now on LWR. And as it progresses, the radio part of it got more intense than the sound system. The sound system kind of took a backseat, and people started booking Daddy Ernie as opposed to Hawkeye Records. You know, and we progressed through the 80s. And then we got, of course, to the 90s, where these community licenses were being issued, for want of a better word. And Choice was created, sent the tape in. They said they never even listened to the tape. They just saw Daddy Ernie and said, yeah, he's going to do the radio show, the reggae show.
That's all they needed to know. And they just gave you the license. Just your association was enough. Just give them the license. Daddy Ernie's involved, of course.
And we got... the 5-day a week reggae show, which, you know, even now I'm really sort of chuffed and honoured to have done that show, because there's never been a 5-day a week reggae show on legal radio. And even today, there's not even one on radio. So, you know, outside of the Caribbean, that was the show, Super Jam. And boy, did we have a ball. And I don't want to take up too much time. That's just a brief outline of what it's all about. So, yeah. We're here. We're going to look for. I'm looking forward to it. And I'm sure we'll put some pieces in.
So, I mean, all right. So I'm going to come back to you in a second, Ernie. So thanks for that. Shayna, let me come back to you. Now, you are Brent. Yeah. Where are you in Brent?
Well, I live in Greenford, so like west, but near Brent.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I mean, but you spent time in Brent, yeah? I mean, yeah,
I've got family from like all over Northwest. So whether it's Harden, Wilson, or Harrow, all over Northwest.
So give us your impression of the area. I mean, how do you feel about it? I mean, you know, for me, it's an amazing, vibrant area. But what are your kind of feelings about the Brent area?
I mean, I spent a lot of time growing up in the Brent area, so it's a place that's very close. My heart, my childhood, and my life, and I think some of my first raves were in Halsden. My first parties, and I was when I was quite young. So all a lot of my good memories are attached to that place. And there's a lot of culture, and it's so vibrant, and it's so busy, and it's so full of just love and energy. I think Brent is an amazing place to be honest.
Now, Pirate Radio's never really played a part in your life, has it?
Growing up. I listened to a lot of pirate radio in the car with my parents and my dad way back in the day was on Unique FM, but I was a baby, so I he didn't bring me to the studio, which I'm
your dad was on Unique FM. Okay.
Way back. And then
there we go.
I started my radio career at Pulse 88, which is a pirate station in Wembley, and I was there for about a year.
Okay.
And then moved on. So a little bit here and there in terms of career wise, but listening since I was a little girl.
But you never really got chased by the DTI or anything like that?
None of that for me. None of that for me.
Okay, that's great. Thank you for that, Shayna. Erica, let me ask you the same question. I mean, are you in Brent?
Yeah, I'm not in Brent. I might be the only one that isn't from Brent.
Have you come through our glorious borough?
I have. I had a little walk through the borough the other day, actually. I was walking through... I'm putting together a radio show about Brent and No Base Like Home. So I had a little walk around, and one of the things that was so clear to me was I was walking down the high street in Halsden. One of the things that was so clear to me was that, like, there's such a community feel, almost to the point that I felt like an outsider. Like, I felt like I just was a complete outsider. And it wasn't a thing of me, like, being dressed different or anything like that. It was just that you can see people knew each other. So there'd be people standing outside shops talking to each other. And just there was a community feel. And you can feel that in Halsden.
And always loud music, right?
Always loud music. There was so much music. There was like a boombox on my shoulder. You don't see that in Halsden.
I mean, Carnival got cancelled, but it still felt like Carnival was happening in Halsden. It was unbelievable. There was so much noise in Halsden. And like, I went to the Roti Hut the other night, and outside the Roti Hut was a steel pan band just playing.
I can believe it.
I was like, what are you boys doing here? And they were just playing outside the Roti Hut. I couldn't believe it.
Believe it. Yeah.
So, yeah, that is our crazy area. Yeah, I look for it. So you're going to do that for No Base Like Home? You're going to do it?
Yeah. So we're in the middle of making the radio show now. We've got different interviews. The focus of the show is on the first people to do it, or the first things to happen. So like there was an event in 1969, which is called the Caribbean Festival. We're doing a little focus on that. We're talking to people who are involved in radio, Daddy Ernie.
That's why you were talking to Daddy Ernie. Ah, okay.
So, yeah, we're piecing it all together, a little focus on Trojan Records and stuff. So yeah, we're just piecing it all together.
Have you seen that they're about to launch a Trojan Records coffee table book? I just saw it advertised. It's £30. Big, it's like a 12-inch square, big coffee table book full of all the Trojan artwork, lots of photographs that have never been seen before.
Yeah.
Looking forward to that. Mm-hmm. That is going to be good. Thank you, Erica. Thank you very much. Let me come back to my friend Daddy Ernie and just start getting into some of the history. Are we ready for some of the history, Ernie?
Yeah, what do you want to know? Where do we start? Halsden, oh my word.
Yeah, I mean, Halsden, what can you say? What an area. I mean, there's so much pirate radio in Halsden.
Well, my first radio station that I knew about, I mean, apart from Caroline and Invicta and all those, but Black Music Station, was actually DBC,
yeah,
which came out at Grove. And then over in Harlesden now, we had a station called Traffic Jam. We used to operate out of Stonebridge, on the estate in Stonebridge. Then from there, we had Time FM.
Yeah.
And we had Fast FM. They were sort of the early stations before you came up to Unique and Roots. And you had RJR as well. RJR was one of the four runners as well.
Yeah.
Which is still going today, actually.
Yeah.
So, yeah, there was... And you're right. You had, at one stage, you had BFM, which was by the travel agent. Then you come around the corner and you'd have Time FM, which was on top of Ericsson's. And then you go around the other side and it was opposite Orkai. Somewhere along there was Fresh FM. So, yeah, Harlesden really had a feeling of... we like to call them community stations now.
We won't... We,
them times, yeah. We're called pirate.
We won't call them pirate radio stations. Yes. All right, so let's ask the big question. Why were pirate radio stations necessary?
Well, you know, Lindsay, it's very much like today, really. We don't have a representation, even today, in my opinion, of really what it's all about. Definitely since the days of Choice and the early days of Kiss, those early days. But back then, as kids, we was always wanted to be like the Rolling Stones and the Beatles, because that's who we used to know. That's who we used to hear.
Mm.
So we was always on the bed, jumping up and down and strumming the guitar and being Mick Jagger and rear. Then after a while now, you got My Boy Lollipop and you got the Pioneers and you got Desmond Dekker and people like this. And you hear a little bit of their tunes, but it wasn't consistent. And that was like to the latter part of the 60s. In the 70s now, which people say was the golden era of reggae, you had Steve Barnard and yep. Tony Williams
yep.
on radio on BBC, and you had Roddington on the Saturday night on Capital Radio.
Yeah.
But once again, it was just sporadic. So I think the need for pirate station was very evident in them times there, because growing up as youths, we wanted to hear. We had gone through the sound system here, and now we wanted to hear our music on radio. It was reggae, R&B, soca, whatever it was, we wanted to hear it on reggae. So pirate radio was essential at that time. When it came along, it was essential. And it proved it with the popularity. You know, Lindsay, Capital was screaming when LWR and Kiss was on the air. They were literally screaming, get them off, because we was just taking away their audience. You know? It's the music that we played, the music, as the pirate anthem says, we play the music that the people want, and they wanted it in abundance.
Well, initially, Radio One created a comedy show taking the mick out of Kiss FM DJs, because they didn't think we talked properly. You know, they thought we just talked like regular people, and you know, we didn't sound like radio broadcasters. So they created a little comedy show on Radio One, taking the mick out of us. And you know, initially when we came on, they were all like, ha ha ha, look at these council estate people. And and then like a couple of years later, they stole a whole set of our presenters and producers. Who were still working at the BBC to this day.
Yep, they realised that these people from the council estates spoke the language of your everyday people. You know, we didn't want to hear no posh talk. We wanted to hear it as it was and as the music was. So, yeah, they realised quickly.
I mean, from my perspective on Radio 1 and Capital, you know, they were playing like the A-list artists, you know, the Diana Ross and the Stevie Wonder and the Marvin Gaye and whatever. And they were playing like the crossover reggae hits, like, you know, John Holt, Help Me Make It Through the Night, or Ken Booth, Everything I Own. But it's like, we knew underneath all of that top layer, there were layers and stratas and layers and stratas, and people, you know, that they were not playing, they were never getting a chance to hear. And when Norman Jay started playing James Brown and Maceo and the Max and the Jackson Sisters on his, you know, on his radio show, people were losing their minds. It's like, what is this music? Where has it come from? And we had to say to them, you know, it actually came out back in the 60s and the 70s, but you never got a chance to hear it.
Yeah. I mean, the house party is, you know, you could go to a house party, you know, Mystery and people like that, where they were doing these rare groove things or songs that they were playing there.
Mm.
No hope of hearing those songs on British radio. No hope.
Yeah.
So pirate stations were essential, especially for our community, you know, and people gravitated to it from outside of our community. And boy, did it take off.
Mm.
So much so that the Radio Authority, in their infinite wisdom in the early 90s, decided they were going to hand out some stations, as they say, as they done with Radio 1. Because if you remember, Radio 1 was a pirate station and they bought it in because it became so popular.
Mm.
KISS LWR became so popular that they bought Choice and KISS. Well, they bought in KISS and Choice was created because Choice was never really a pirate station. And it was the sheer popularity of what was going on, the whole movement, you know, various artists that was going on, that forced them to do that.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Thanks for that. Thanks for that, Ernie. I'm going to come back to you, Shayna, because, I came out of pirate radio and, you know, my first shows on pirate radio were rubbish. I mean, they were just rubbish. I can't stress this enough to you. You know, my first shows were rubbish, but I didn't have any training. I didn't go to any school to learn how to do radio. I was just, you know, Gordon Mack just brought me on KISS because, you know, he said I knew lots of stuff. So it's like, can you tell us about your journey? You know, I mean, you said that your dad was on a pirate station. You said he was on Unique.
Yeah.
How did you learn to do what you do? Because I'm sure we've got a lot of young people watching and they want to get to where you are. So can you tell us a little about your journey?
Yeah, of course. So I started at the age of about 20, I think I was. And I kind of jumped headfirst into a show on a station called Pulse 88, which is a pirate station. And it said, like you said, Lindsay, my first show was a mess. It was just like, it was ridiculous. Lights up, I didn't know what buttons to press. And I had a co-host and we were literally just both so oblivious to what we had to do or anything. But we just put the mics up and then we played some music and we had a little chat and it was super fun. It sounded awful, but it was super fun. And we had a really good time. And then I think the greatness in my first year of radio was literally just learning on the job ourselves. So every week we come in with like new ideas and they have to figure out how to do it ourselves and just kind of like go with it and have a great time. So I was at Pulse 88 for a year, and then I went over to a station called Westside, which is in West London in Hanwell.
Yeah.
And I was there for about 4 years, and then there I kind of perfected my craft, I'd say. So it was like listening to more like commercial radio there I was, and learning how to speak up to certain times and improve my links and understanding how playlist works and times and everything like that, to really like hone in on what I wanted to do.
But did you look around looking for a school where you could maybe learn how to do this stuff?
I didn't think there was one. Obviously there is, like, you can get degrees and stuff, and there are schools that you can go to from I think like 16, like colleges and stuff like that, but I didn't think it was. I thought it was one of those things you just kind of just learn as you go along and learn from your elders and learn from those around you.
Yeah.
So literally just on the job, winging it as you kind of go and growing from there and getting better, essentially. So yeah, I was there for about 3 years. I want to say 3 years. Everything's a blur. I'm getting old. I can't remember anything anymore. There for about 3 years, and then moved on to Capital Selection, which I've been there for about 2 years now.
I mean, when you were growing up, what were the kind of voices that influenced you? Were there any presenters out there that kind of made you think, yeah, I want to do that?
I think when I was younger, I think I got a shout out once from Rudy Ranks. And I was so excited. I just didn't know how he was in the radio and he said my name. And I was like, Mom, like, what happened? That's my one of my very first radio experiences, remembering that. And as I got a little bit older, there was a sound, I think it was Jaguan Sound, and they played, I think it was on Unique, they had like a weekly show, and it was like 2 hours, and it was, I was a fan of their dances anyway, so I'd like listen to their radio show like with conviction.
Yeah.
And then of course Jenny Francis as well on Choice, that was a good one for me, and Phoebe won on Bang, so The Beat, but when it was Bang.
Yeah.
There's a few names that I kind of remember, but I didn't really, I can honestly say I didn't, you know, radio was a real job until I started it. I didn't think it was, as a child, I was like, oh, they're just playing music and speaking from the thing in the car. And then I kind of grew up and I was like, oh, this is, people do this. This is real life. So yeah, there's a few names.
It's really good to hear you hail out Jenny Francis, who we love, and also Phoebe One, who I'm fairly certain is a Brent resident as well. So, you know, I think Jenny's in Willesden. So, you know, pioneers, female pioneers of radio.
Yeah, exactly that. It's nice for that. It's nice.
Love them. Okay, thank you for that. Erica, can I ask you the same question? I need you to talk a little about your radio station, because Worldwide FM is it's a very interesting radio station.
Yeah.
And you kind of do need very specialist knowledge to hold your own in that environment.
My TV has just come on randomly. Let me just quickly turn it off.
These are the joys of Zoom meetings. It's like how many memes are we seeing these days about Zoom meetings? It's so funny.
I'm in my front room. I haven't done a Zoom in my front room yet, but I thought I'd change up the background.
So your journey, I mean, did you kind of learn on the job like Shayna and me?
Yeah, well, kind of and kind of not, actually. So I remember being, from a young age, I always kind of knew what I wanted to do. And my sister, older sister, used to work for IPC Media, which they used to put out loads of magazines like NME and Now Magazine, when it was Now Magazine or whatever it is, Marie Claire and all those magazines.
Yeah. She worked
in that building and she invited me in. I came in and I sat with her just to see what she does. And I was probably like 12. And she took me up to the Now area and I was like, actually, I kind of like the environment. I like how crazy and intense it is. I want to be a journalist. And before that, I'd always wanted to be, I saw like the Fern Cottons and the Reggie Yates on TV and I was like, I want to be a presenter. So I'd always be transforming my room into some sort of like Blue Peter style environment. Like I'd cut out loads of paper leaves and stick them around and be like, this is my jungle, and I'd present. And so I kind of knew I had an interest in media, and then I didn't really realize, like Shayna, I didn't really realize radio could be a job.
Yeah.
But I went to a panel that the BBC was hosting and there were loads of radio presenters, and I was like, god, that sounds like a really fun job. And it was as simple as that. I was just kind of like, that sounds like a really fun job. And at the time I was like 13, and I was like, mom, I don't know, I want to do this, but I don't know how to get in, like how do I get in? Because everywhere either requires you to be over 18 or to have a degree.
Mm.
So, you know, if you wanted to learn about radio, you had to either be one of those two things or hospital radio, which was, again, they kind of wanted you to be 18 at the time. And so a couple years kind of went by, still was really interested in radio, and my mom's friend actually works for the council, and she said, oh, let me help you out, you know, we do like a career kind of thing, let me help you out. So she looked around and she was looking for radio opportunities, and the Roundhouse was one of the first ones on the list, and she said, oh, check this out, if you're interested you can go to that, if you're not, then I've got a whole list of other places you can go to.
Oh, interesting.
That was my entrance in. And so I went to the Roundhouse. They used to do a drop-in on Thursdays, which before the pandemic they were still doing. And you'd pay, I think I paid like £2 to go in and learn about radio every Thursday with a tutor who has worked in radio, knows the industry. And my tutor was like one of my favorite people in terms of my career, like completely transformed my life. Her name was Marie Horner. And she,
where did she work?
She used to work for the BBC, but she now works for the Roundhouse.
Okay.
But she used to work for the BBC across those different things, and she studied media, like she knew her stuff. And then, yeah, so I did that, and I remember like being so nervous, like so nervous, like my armpits were sweating, like I was just a mess, but I wanted to learn. And I remember for me going in there, I felt like, you know, at school it kind of takes a while to kind of figure out your levels almost, like you'd have to do an exam to figure out whether you're an A, B or C or whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
But with this, I can actually, like, I felt like I was improving, and that for me was a total buzz. And I think I got addicted to that. It was like, 1 week I'd come in and I was nervous to come on the mic. And then the next week I'd feel a bit more confident to go on the mic. And then the next week I was able to move the fader at the same time. And the next week I knew what buttons to press. And it was kind of, it was totally addictive to for me. So I was 15, did that. Then I was at the Roundhouse for a few years. That was incredible. I had a radio show there. And then I started working at Sky News. So after school, I didn't go to uni. I did an internship for a year at Sky News, which was one of the most intense things ever. But whilst I was on a night shift, I tweeted Giles Peterson because I was listening to his radio show, because my mentor had said at the time, "Oh, Erica, have you heard of Giles Peterson?" And I was like, "No, I don't really know who he is, but like I know a few people I know follow him on Facebook."
Mm.
But I didn't know who he was. And she was like, "You should listen to the show. I'm surprised you don't know anything about the show, because you're playing, like, your music is like pretty much identical. You're playing the same sort of stuff." And like, I'm genuinely surprised. And I was like, "Okay, cool, I'll check it out." I listened and I was like, I tuned in for the full 3 hours. He was at Six Music at this point in his career. I was like, "Oh my God, this man kind of, he gets what's going on in my brain." And like, it's so, you know, it's so crazy that it's like, I was listening to all this music that he would also play, but I had no idea who he was. So then I tweeted him on a night shift. I was doing a 12-hour shift, coming at Sky News at like 7 p.m. I was leaving at 7 a.m. the next day. And I sent a tweet out being like, "Oh my God, I'd love to shadow your producer." And I didn't expect him to see it. I didn't expect him to read it, whatever. I was just like, "I'm just going to throw it out there, take a chance." He then tweeted me back and was like, "Oh, come in." And I was like, "Oh, okay." Like, I came in and then I sat there really nervously, like, "Oh my God, I can't believe I'm like in the studio. I'm at the BBC at Six Music." And yeah, so I've known Giles since I was about maybe 18. I'm 25 now. And then just kind of, I guess our paths kept meeting back. And when he set up Worldwide FM, I looked at it as a station. I was like, I could totally be on that station. Like, I know he's kind of got all his like good friends on there and they know so much about music, but
yeah,
I totally see myself on there, and I'm gonna find a way to present a show because I think I can totally do it. And then I jumped on Worldwide. Definitely missing out bits of what's happened so far, but like, that's kind of the basic of what's happened.
Is that Roundhouse thing still going?
In theory, I think it could. I mean, I don't know. I think if the pandemic clears up, or once people are allowed.
But
then people will be able to go in. But to my knowledge, up until March, people were still going in every Thursday.
Okay, so that's a cool place to go.
Brilliant place to go. Like, really incredible.
So much. And we appreciate your courage. Nothing ventured, nothing gained. You're tweeting Giles Peterson in the middle of the night.
I know, big risk. I was like, I didn't even think it. But I thought, let me just give it a shot. And like, I've got nothing to lose.
Nothing ventured, nothing gained. We love that. Yeah, good for you. Good for you. But you really must have good knowledge, though, because, you know, Giles is not going to just hire anybody. So you must be good.
I think it's one of those things where I see a lot of, I'm just a listener. Like, I love listening to new music, and I think I'm someone that's curious. So, like, you know, I haven't got like 40 years of knowledge in my brain. I just can't do it. But like, I'm learning, and my ears are always open, and my ears are always to the ground for new music. And I think, I don't know why Giles wanted me on there, but I can assume it's because I've always got my ear to the ground. So
you're curious. Always be curious. Yeah. Always be curious. That's good. Yeah. Fantastic. Okay, thanks for that, Erica. Let me come back to Ernie now, and just do some more, a little more history with you, but also some philosophical questions as well, and some economic questions as well, Ernie, because, you know, I mean, as the lyrics say in Pirates' Anthems, you know, if you wanted your dance ram, you know, advertise on pirate radio. So how important was pirate radio to the black economy?
Well, at the time, it was extremely important because you couldn't advertise on commercial radio because they weren't playing the music that related to what you wanted to do. And it was just so extremely expensive, not unless you wanted to advertise like at 2 o'clock in the morning or something like that. But you couldn't advertise in breakfast or drive time.
Mm.
So when, you know, when Pirates came along, you know, Lindsay, you can drop a little money and your ads running very much the same as like these days, running every half an hour, every hour, your ads are running. And them time, I think it was a different vibe them time there, Lindsay, because, you know, there weren't no postcode business or anything like that. You could go, LWR was over in Crystal Palace, and we keep a dance over in East London. I forget that big venue that they had over in East London, up in Forest Gate, Woodgrange Road. Massive venue.
Yeah, yeah.
You could keep a dance there, and there wouldn't be no problem about people coming from different areas. Nowadays, it's a lot different. You know, the youths, they can't venture too far out of their thing. So,
how tragic is that?
Oh, it's absolutely ridiculous because, I mean, even now, you know, I can go, and I'm sure yourself, we can go anywhere in any borough and go and do our business or just pass through or go and see some friends or anything and don't worry about anything. The kids nowadays, they can't do that.
Yeah. But pirate radio stations helped shops, helped dances, helped record companies, helped
everybody. It was a huge economic movement, and there was huge stars. There was big stars, so you know you kept a dance and you got the right stars. You know, we look back and we think of people like the Chimes, you know, R&B group, the Chimes, and people like this. You was keeping an all dayer, and you had about five acts and five DJs, and like 2,000 people.
Mm.
You know, it was absolutely huge. And like you say, you had the Soul to Soul Collective over in Camden, who spawned a whole movement of clothes and music and everything. So much so that this country didn't even recognize Jazzy B and that whole Soul to Soul movement. He got awards in America before he got awards here, which was ridiculous, you know? So, it was, you can't emphasize how important those early community stations, call them community stations, what part they played in the whole music setup here in the UK. People like Jetstar, Lightning, Trojan was before, but Jetstar, Lightning, Dub Vendors, Hawkeye Records, all these people spawned that generation of community stations. It's phenomenal. Absolutely.
I mean, as you say, the kind of scale of money we're talking about, I mean, you know, these kind of companies, they literally had probably a couple of £100 to do marketing. And, you know, and that wouldn't have bought you a cup of tea at a big station.
Wouldn't got your sandwich.
wouldn't have got you a cup of tea or a sandwich at a big station. But, you know... But you could get a week's worth of advertising on a pirate radio station for a couple of hundred quid.
Easy. I mean, you know, the records that the pirate stations of that time broke. I remember this record. I mean, you know, we broke a lot of reggae records, but there was this record called 19 by Paul Hardcastle.
Mm-hmm.
And anyone you talk to will tell you that LWR. You might not say that, but anyone who you speak to might tell you that LWR broke that record. And it was just a matter, I mean, they called it payola at that time, but you know, we didn't know it was a payola. A man just give you money and you just beat that tune to death. You know what I mean? You just advertise it and beat it senseless. And Paul Hardcastle went on and became a huge star.
Now, Ernie, you're giving me some good information here. Now, I didn't know this. So are you telling me the record company gave LWR money to play that tune?
Hello, come on, Lindsay. Didn't you get money on Kiss? Get out of here.
I wish. I didn't get any money.
Somebody did. I know that for a fact, right? Because that was how it went in them days. You know what I mean? Maxi Priest and all these people, Smiley Culture, all these people came from the community stations of that era. Huge, huge. And yeah, of course record companies gave radio stations money. We ain't hiding that.
I remember when I used to listen to Radio Luxembourg and they actually had something called the Power Play.
And that's it.
I have to assume the record company gave them money.
That's what we had, Power Play on LWR.
Well, I wasn't actually going to talk about economics in that respect, to be honest.
Wanted to talk about the underground economics.
No, I want to talk about how pirate radio helped businesses in Harlesden and Brent, and how pirate radio helped record companies begin, how artists were able to launch their careers.
Yep. There's no two ways about it. I mean, Omar, there's nothing like this. One of the biggest R&B songs in UK history. They came out of Northwest London. Their offices was run by Manor Park Road and on Craven Park.
Yeah.
Huge. And they came through the community stations.
Yeah.
You know, Jetstar, huge distribution. Anybody who's in music knows about Jetstar. Lightning Records, all these people made a great living out of music in the Brent area, and the community stations was very significant in that movement.
Okay, that's
marvelous. There's nothing wrong with it. Now they call it entrepreneurs, gangsters.
Okay,
you know, it's great.
That's great. Thanks for that. Thanks for that. Shayna, let me come back to you and let me just talk to you about radio and lockdown, because, you know, you are doing a daily radio show and you must know how much pleasure and how much comfort and how much companionship you give to people every morning on your radio show. You know, what's the feedback you've been getting from people? Because I think at this time, radio has been a godsend to some people.
I think it has, like you said, it has been a godsend. And I think it was in the year we've had, it was like a bit of light. It was like a nice reminder that you can go to the radio, you can be comforted and you can have company and you can basically be in a room with your friends and the like. So it's been a very tough year. My co-host was working from home from March till I think just after July. So for a very long time, she was at home. I was in the studio and we were trying to make it work from there. And it worked, it was great, it was fine. But the difference in the output was of course there. But the feedback has been like amazing from our listeners and people who have been working from home, isolating alone as well. And it was nice to have, they said it was nice to have like friendly voices with them through the time. A very weird year, of course, for everyone, but it is nice to be part of somebody's journey on an everyday day-to-day basis anyways, but to be kind of like a little bit of light in the lockdown, it has been really nice.
I mean, as you say, there are some people in lockdown who have been by themselves in isolation, and you know, radio has been their friend, their constant companion.
So
what's the kind of feedback you've had? What have people said to you?
Just things like just general thank yous. They've been super nice, and they tend to come in after a few months. So it would be like, thank you girls for keeping me company for the last 3 months. And then it's like a reminder that people have been listening every day and they show up on time and they put on their radio to listen to us and to enjoy the banter and to enjoy the music and just feel like part of something whilst they're not going through the best time. So it's just been a lot of general thank yous, a lot of laughs with us and a lot of jokes and just general friendship, I think is nice to have through the art of radio.
And have you felt the weight of that responsibility? I mean, people's days, people's moods, you know, people's lives have been dependent on you being super happy.
Yeah, it is. It has been tough. I mean, the job that we do, that we've all done, is to go on air and to give yourself in whatever form you're in. So you can't really, you can have a bad day on radio, but you can't really. You are there for the people. So you are there to bring the entertainment, to bring the joy. So it's been a tough one. It has been a bit heavy at times, but I'm very grateful to have like a great working environment, a great co-host, a great producer. So work is a good time for me.
You couldn't have a bad day, could you?
Yeah, I'm just like, yeah, going to work, cool. It's dark outside, it's 4:30, but we're doing this and we're having a good time and we're making people happy and making people's day. So yeah, it's been nice.
Good for you. I know you've made a lot of people very happy. I know you have. Erica, let me ask you the same question. Have you felt how powerful radio is at this time?
Oh my God, yes. Like, yes, 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 yes. Like, I was doing More by Daily, which is the name of my show, before lockdown. And I was, like, we were going through things together. So, you know, from the beginning of lockdown, when it was like, oh my God, people were confused. People didn't really, like, you know, even now, the government kind of don't really know what they're doing. No one really knows what they're doing. And it felt like our radio numbers skyrocketed the moment we went into lockdown. We got numbers that we kind of never seen before. And it was a combination of, you know, a few things, but I think it was because lockdown really made people kind of stop and think about community, which is so important to us at Worldwide. We call each other the Worldwide family. So if you're a DJ on Worldwide, or if you're someone that goes to the gigs or the festivals or whatever, you're part of the Worldwide family. We're included in that. And you could be anywhere in the world. I had listeners in Japan, Mexico, like all over, people waking up at 6 a.m. and I'd be the first voice that they'd hear.
Oh, wonderful.
Dancing, China Moses, who's a singer, sent me a message being like, oh my God, I'm dancing in my pajamas. And I was like, oh my God, I'm dancing in my pajamas too. Like, and it was just one of those things where it was just like so comforting. We're all together, all, you know, we're all still going through this, but the initial lockdown where no one really knew what the end date was.
Yeah.
It was heavy. And then of course, Black Lives Matter happened at the end of May, beginning of June. And for me as a radio presenter, and as a Black person, that was really heavy. And coming back to the radio, because I took a bit of time off, coming back to the radio, that was intense, because I felt like, oh my God, like I may be the first Black voice that they've heard today. And now I need to say something that kind of shows how I feel, shows what we represent Worldwide.
That is quite a responsibility, wow. Yeah.
And so during that time particularly, I feel like everyone became even more vulnerable, because you are either on the receiving end, or you have a history of being on the receiving end of racism, or you're on the side of the oppressor, and maybe there's times when you haven't realised that you've been the oppressor. And that, for everyone, I think it kind of just, it was a big wake-up call where everyone was just like, this is really intense. And so just reminding people that, like, you know, you may have just realized that, you know, race is a thing. And if that's the case, let's kind of think about it, because you can't unsee some of the things you've seen on social media. So let's think about how we move forward. So that was something that I was really keen on doing. And it really did bring people together, I found. And yeah, it was just the whole of lockdown was really intense, but it really showed the powerfulness of community And that was, for me, that's what Worldwide's about. That's what radio's about.
Community. Oh, definitely. Definitely, definitely. Zerritha, you look as though you want to say something.
Yes, I'm really enjoying the conversation. But I know that we've got 15 minutes left and I want to get into some of the questions that are coming.
Oh, okay. Yeah, go for it.
Okay, so there is a question from Steve to Shayna and Erica. The question is, do you feel the weight of the Pirate Radio Pioneers legacy that they have taken on themselves? Do you feel the weight of the Pirate Legacy, Pirate Radio Legacy Pioneers, and do you feel that you've taken this on yourself? And like, how are you using that, I suppose, in terms of your roles and positions now in mainstream radio and in internet radio?
Yeah. I mean, for me, I feel like I'm always, because of this Worldwide family, there's people that know Giles and stuff. And so I always am seeing all these people that used to be on Kiss FM back in the day and whatnot, like Patrick Forge or whatever, like these big kind of names that have like made a big impact in radio. And so I'm always like, oh God, like I am, in some ways I am continuing that, but I am, online radio does feel slightly different to a pirate radio. I think some of the key things that we're like doing that's the same is that we're playing music that isn't heard off, well, at least on our station, that isn't heard on mainstream radio a lot of the time. We're giving people the first chance to get played. So yeah, no, I do feel the weight of that. But I think it's like, I feel like I'm standing on really strong shoulders in terms of what the people have done in the past. And I think they've given us so much room to keep growing and to be the best version, like be the best presenters we can be and best DJs we can be. So I do feel the weight of the legacy, absolutely.
Similar to what Erica said, I do feel like we're standing on some very strong shoulders and the weight is there, and it's nice to be able to continue what I've kind of grown up around and learned. And like I said, my dad being on Unique FM back in the day, if I get something wrong on radio, he will tell me about it. He will me and bad me up and pull me up and X, Y, and Z. So it's nice to have that around and kind of I pride myself on not necessarily impressing, but when I get feedback from those that really matter to me and those that I've looked up to in the past, that means a lot to me. So I feel like from those kind of things, I feel like I'm doing a good job. I'm continuing the legacy and I'm working pretty hard. So yeah.
You got another question for us, Zerritha?
I do. So I have another.
You've muted yourself. Don't know how you did that.
What do each of the presenters see as their responsibilities as voices and curators of music on the radio?
Ooh, that's a good question. I mean, the radio station that I work for, I work on My Soul, and you know, I do a show every Saturday called the A to Z of My Soul Music, and you know, my responsibility is to tell stories. You know, I play music, but I also give a lot of biographical detail as well, because I feel very, very strongly that, you know, there are some amazing artists and we know their music, but we don't necessarily know their stories. So I do a lot of biographical detail in my show, and I feel that's my responsibility. And people are like, Lindsay, I've been listening to this artist for 30, 40 years and I didn't know all of this about them. And, you know, it's what an amazing story. So, you know, I feel that's my responsibility. I love telling stories. I love history. So that's what I'm supposed to be doing, and I really enjoy doing that every week.
Yeah, I'll just come in on there, Lindsay. I mean, you know, my responsibility is immense. Being, you know, a reggae presenter, and we don't make no bones about that. We can play other genres, but primarily we're a reggae presenter. And, you know, we're on Vibes 3 times, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. Over the lockdown, we're doing Thursday and Friday mornings and Sundays. I mean, the only day we get a break is 6. But, you know, every time I go on air, we play what I consider the best in reggae and the occasional dancehall as well, because it's a genre that has been vilified for years. And at the end of it, it's the source of the majority of music that you hear today, i.e. rap, grime, the whole genre. It's all come from reggae.
No doubt.
Whether it's dancehall or whatever. So our, my responsibility is to showcase that at the top of the pile.
No doubt. What's your responsibility, Shayna?
I think mine, as the breakfast presenter, our job is to provide the entertainment, to provide the news, to provide the joy, to provide just the basis of someone's just beginning of their day, to be honest. And as I think, as forward-facing Black woman on the station that I'm on, I think it's my responsibility to provide representation. As me and my co-host are two Black women and the first Black woman to host the breakfast show. So it's quite a big responsibility, and we've been doing it, you know, we've been doing it good. And I think just moving forward with that is what is my path and my focus and what I want to be really good at, to be honest. So yeah.
Wow, you are breaking new ground. That is amazing.
Yeah.
Well done you. That's amazing. Erica, what's your responsibility?
I think it's a combination of everyone's. It is that sort of being a representation is kind of showing like another Black girl, Black woman, young woman, or anyone that you can totally do it, and that you can do it. Like it's not, well, you know, at times, of course, there's times where radio may be difficult, but it's doable. If you have an interest in it, you can totally achieve all the things you want to achieve in it.
Yeah, I mean, Shayna was talking about the pioneers like Jenny Francis and Phoebe One, and got a hail out Angie Greaves, of course. And you know, you two are, there's a lot of young women listening to you and just going, wow. Like Shayna said, wow, this could be a job. I could turn this into a job.
Hey, Lindsay, so, you know someone I'd like to hail out? The ranking Miss P.
Oh, of course. Absolutely.
Female presenter on any station.
She was the original, the absolute first.
Original.
Wonderful woman. You know what I mean? Wonderful woman.
Yes.
The ranking Miss P. Zerritha, you got another question for us?
Yep, I do. So pirate radio is often seen as providing a safe space for young people of the time. Do you feel now that radio still provides a safe space for young people, for people, but particularly young people now?
Do you know what? I never felt that pirate radio was a safe space. It didn't feel like a safe space to me. It felt like quite a dangerous place to be honest.
It could be dangerous.
I think the stations that Shayna and Erica are working on now are safe spaces for people to work, safe stations for people to listen to, you know, in comparison to the stations we worked on. I mean, on the stations we worked on, you could hear some pretty offensive music sometimes. Yeah. And hear some pretty offensive comment as well. It was unregulated. So
I think that the youngsters of today, really, it's a completely different kind of vibe, because they can find somewhere where they teach them how to present and do radio, how people visualize it's supposed to be done. Whereas with us, you know, I came from a sound system background and just landed on a radio station. I mean, I was sitting in the studio and think, I can't call myself Ernie Harriet, because that's not a really radio-friendly name. What am I going to call myself? And I thought, I'll just call myself Daddy, because Daddy Uroy was the man of the time. Boom, next thing. And they said, you can't call yourself that. I remember when I went to a station, I won't mention the station, but it was a significant station for an interview. They said, you can't call yourself that. I said, what are you talking about? That was my name. You know what I mean? I mean, I didn't get the job. That was another story altogether. And that will come in the book in due time. You know what I mean? But yeah, there was things that, you know, it was so difficult. Now it's a lot easier. And still, you know, we still are not seeing a great representation on a station like a Capital or a Radio One, or even there's tons of stations, but you're not seeing, you know, there might be, you know, the odd couple of that, but there's more than two people from the community, black community, who can go on the radio stations, Lindsay. We can all speak Queen's English when we want to. Oh, we can do it yard style.
Zerritha, you got anything else for us?
Yeah, I do.
Go for it.
So, do you like or dislike doing a playlisted show tunes?
Ooh, that's one for Shayna.
Yeah, so do I like or dislike doing a playlisted show? Is that the question, yeah?
Yeah, so do you like or dislike doing a playlist show tunes, yeah?
Okay, so yeah, so Monday to Friday on The Breakfast Show, my show is completely playlisted. Like, we have no say, no nothing. We just go in and the music is there and it's done. It is nice in a sense, because to be honest, then we can focus on what we are supposed to do as presenters for a breakfast show. So I do like that side of it. And I do like playing the biggest songs. And I do like playing the best songs at the moment of the time. My Friday night show is completely me. Like, I get to pick whatever. I have full control of what I want to play for 2 hours on a Friday night. So like I said at the beginning, I really get the best of both worlds. I can have a playlisted show and I can just chat, or I can mix, I can DJ, I can juggle, and I can go in for 2 hours and play whatever. So I gotta say, it's like there's no like or dislike. I get to do both, so I'm quite happy. I'm quite lucky, to be honest. Yeah.
Let me answer the question as well, Zerritha, because I have, you know, I'm a radio presenter, but I've also been a head of music. You know, I was head of music at Kiss FM for 4 years, and you know, I created MTV Bass, so you know, I created a playlist for MTV Bass as well. And you know, the reason I got into this was to break new music and to break new artists. And the wonderful thing for me about playlist is if I put a tune on the playlist, you know, I'm going to be hearing that brilliant new song by that brilliant new artist 30, 40 times a week. And that for me is the thrill, because it's like, if I put that brand new tune by that brand new artist on the playlist, we're going to help to break that artist. And if I can help to break the artist, then playlist worked its magic. So, you know, I'm a big fan. If you love new music and you love new artists, you know, those new artists want to be on a playlist. Talk to the new artists. They want to be on the playlist because they know the power of playlists. So, you know, I've seen it from both sides.
I mean, we broke Shaggy and people like that without a playlist on Choice, because we never had no reggae playlist. We had one, two songs that we added, but we broke them without no playlist. So, hey, I'm not really one for a playlist, Lindsay. I think if you've got the knowledge and that, you can put it together. Even on my Vibe show now, I've got some, I know on a Monday, I'm going to be playing these songs for the week. I'm going to be playing it for the month. It's up in there. Because it takes away the personality. If you've got a playlist, you just go in there and do some computer business, and the links are short, and it just takes away the personality. Boom.
Zerritha, have we run out of time?
You've got
put some more money left in the meter.
We've got what?
1 minute left.
1 minute left? Ooh. If I ask Ernie a question, he's never going to summarise anything in a minute.
No.
Let me ask, Ernie, you've got 60 seconds, mate.
Go on.
Ernie, what makes Brent so special?
Oh, the people in Brent are magnificent. I've been very fortunate to work in a greengrocer shop, and I've probably sold Caribbean food to every single youth, grandmother, great-grandmother. And even in 2020, I walk through Arsden and I just feel like I'm on cloud nine. There's nowhere like Arsden. Special.
There you very go. Special. There you go. We live in a great borough, Zerritha.
Yeah, man. Brent, wicked for life.
Wicked. And that's it. We're done.
Well, we're done. Yeah, thank you, everybody. Thank you to Lindsay, Shayna, Erica and Ernie for a fantastic conversation tonight around the history of pirate radio, but also for yourselves, Shayna and Erica, talking about, like, the future of radio and also like what you're doing for the next generation. So you're smashing it. So yeah, thank you everybody. Just before we wrap up, what I wanted to just let you know is the next two panels that we have coming up. So the Reggae Uni- the